Hello viewers, welcome to Studio NIS. I am Dr. Pooja Chopra. Today we will discuss about management approaches, nature and scope. Humans are the biggest resource for any country. Humans can be transformed into resource by education. Education is fundamental to growth and development. The human mind makes possible all development, achievements, from health advances and agriculture innovations to efficient public administration and private sector growth. For countries to reap these benefits fully, they need to unleash the potential of human mind. And there is no better tool for doing so than education. Education is an engine of growth and key to development in every society, based on its quality and quantity. In order to make a significant contribution to economic growth and development, high quality education is required. The 21st century paradigm is shifting towards the enhancement of knowledge as a priority. So, in this 21st century, knowledge is priority. Ours is called as a knowledge-based society. To quote Wendy Kapp, education is the most powerful tool countries have for boosting economic growth, increasing prosperity, and forging more just, peaceful, and equitable societies. Where educational deprivation exists, it breeds conflict and enables repression. Very true. To quote again, human capitals can be increased through education and training. Indeed, education is a power. Education is also an economic good. Economists regard education as both a consumer and capital good because it offers utility, satisfaction to a consumer, and also serves as an input to develop the human resources necessary for economic and social transformation. The focus on education as capital good related to the concept of human capital, which emphasizes that the development of skills is an important factor in production activities. Remember, Skill India initiative by PM Modi, it is again reinforced the development of skill development. It is widely accepted that education creates improved citizens and helps to upgrade the general standards of living in a society. The increased faith in education as an agent of change in many developing countries has led to heavy investments in it. The pressure for higher education in many developing countries has undoubtedly been being helped by the public perception of financial reward from pursuing such education. There is a belief that expanding educational opportunities and access promotes economic growth. Education and training of people increases income of the family, community, society, and country at large. It would imply that education and training is treated as an investment, and like expensive machinery, education is expected to earn profit in return to those who invest in education and training. Education for all is a universal goal that all nations strive to achieve. All goals can be achieved if the schools and institutions are managed properly, if the education system of our country is managed properly. In this lecture, we will explore the nature and scope of various management approaches and discuss how investment in education can lead to economic development of a nation. Let us first begin with management. As you all know that management is efficiency in climbing the ladder of success. This famous quote is given by famous manager Stephen Covey. Management helps in achieving goals of a school and education system. Good management in all spheres can fulfill the goals of education for all. Now we will move on to definitions of management. According to Henry Fayol, to manage is to forecast and to plan, to organize, to command, to coordinate, and to control. Donald J. Close says, management is the art and science of decision making and leadership. So all school principals and teachers should be good decision makers. They should be good leadership. Again, to quote Harold Schoons and Hans Welrick, management is the process of designing and maintaining an environment in which individuals working together in groups efficiently accomplish selected aims. Meaning of management. Hence, management is a distinct process consisting of planning, organizing, directing, and controlling and evaluating to accomplish the predetermined objectives of an institution through the coordinate uses of human and material resources. It is the accomplishment of results through the effects, through the efforts of other people. Now we will discuss concept of 5 M's of school management. Management of any organization, whether it's school or institutions or hospitals, there are 5 M's. For example, in school management, the inputs are infrastructure, facilities, funds, teachers and students, methods of teaching learning process, and the outputs are achievement of students in the academics, co-curricular activities, teachers' professional growth, etc. The 5 M's are, thus input consists of manpower. Manpower is men and women, materials, machinery, methods, and money. All these resources are known as 5 M's of management, and an effective manager is one who is able to use all these resources to have maximum output. So effective management is a necessity, and various management approaches should be used to achieve the goal of universalization of education. Let us discuss the nature and scope of various management approaches. Working population of a country, say 18 to 65 years of age, can be considered as a manpower for our country. Literate manpower is an asset. Goals of literacy can be achieved by sending children of age group 6 to 14 years through Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan. You as teachers are doing your duty sincerely to teach these children, for making them literate, so that in their later life, these children, after getting education and acquiring some professional training, are in a position to improve their earning capacity. Think of the schooling facility in your state. Has it not expanded over the years? Think of educational status of your father, forefather, or village community around you. Things have changed. Education is expanding. Those who are primary pass go to the upper primary class, upper primary go to the secondary, and secondary to senior secondary. And in this way, they climb up the ladder of education step by step. Education is considered a lifelong learning because new knowledge and new skills are added day by day. The demand for technical education is increasing. Computer education is reaching in the remote cities and towns. Why? Why it is so? It is simply because it provides differential income to those who possess it and those who do not possess it. Citizens who have this computer literacy are definitely going to earn more. So, education is creating differential in incomes also. In a nutshell, we can say that in the present day world, the outlook of family, community, society, or government towards education has changed considerably. The capacity and ability acquired by human beings through better education and health facilities are used as means to the attainment of rapid economic growth, which is the ultimate aim of the nation. Education is also a millennium development goal. As we have discussed, that management is an activity which is necessary whenever there is a group of people working in an organization. Management aims at guiding their efforts towards achieving a common objective, a goal. Thus, management has to see that tasks are completed and goals are achieved. That is effectiveness with the least amount of resources at a minimum cost. Cost, that is efficiency. Management has therefore been defined as the process of getting things done with the aim of achieving goals effectively and efficiently. We need to analyze this definition. There are certain terms which require elaboration. These are process, effectively and efficiently. Now we will discuss this in detail. Process in the definition means the primary functions or activities that management performs to get things done. Effectiveness in management is concerned with doing the right task, completing activities and achieving goals. In other words, it is concerned with the end result. But it is not enough to just complete the tasks. There is another aspect also, that is being efficient, or we say doing work efficiently. Efficiently means doing the task correctly and with minimum cost. So when we do things efficiently, we do it with minimum cost. There is a kind of cost benefit analysis involved and the relationship between inputs and outputs. If by using less resources, that is the input, more benefits are derived, that is output, then efficiency is increased. As now we have understood the concept and importance of management, let us discuss the nature and scope of management approaches. First, we will discuss about human capital theories. In the early 1960s, the American economist Theodore W. Schultz coined the term human capital to refer to this, to a stock of productive knowledge and skill possessed by workers. Human capital theory rests on the assumption that formal education is highly instrumental and necessary to improve the productive capacity of a population. In short, human capital theorists argue that an educated population is a productive population. It emphasized how education increases the productivity and efficiency of workers by increasing the level of the cognitive stock of the economically productive human capability, which is a product of innate abilities and investment in human beings. The provision of formal education is seen as an investment in human capital, which proponents of the theory have considered as equally or even more worthwhile than that of a physical capital. Human capital theory, or HCT, concludes that investment in human capital will lead to a greater economic outputs. However, the validity of the theory is sometimes hard to prove and contradictory. In the past, economic strength was largely dependent on the tangible physical assets such as land, factory and equipment. Labor was a necessary component, but increase in the value of business come from the investment in capital equipment. Modern economists seems to concur that education and healthcare are the key to improving human capital and ultimately increasing the economic outputs of the nation. The human capital theory emphasizes the need for policymaker to allocate significant resources to the expansion of educational system. Many of the developing nations have thus realized that the principal mechanism for developing human knowledge is the education system. Thus, they invest huge sums of money on education, not only as an attempt to impact knowledge and skill to individuals, but also to impart values, ideas, attitudes and aspirations, which may be in the nation's best development interest. Quality needs to be the focus of educational investments, with learning gains as the key metric of the quality. Resources are too limited and the challenges too big to be designing policies and programs in the dark. We need evidence on what works in order to invest smartly. Learning for all provides the equity goals that underlie education for all. Achieving learning for all will be challenging, but it is the right agenda for the next decade. It is the knowledge and skills that children and youth acquire today that will drive their employability, productivity, health, and well-being in the decades to come. And thus, that will help ensure that their communities and nations thrive. In the long run, investment in education is going to reap results. However, the private demand for education and training, household demand, would depend also on the following consideration. Change, first is the change in the cost of voluntary education, tastes or preference of individuals, household for the education, income of the house, higher the income of the household, higher the capacity to spend on education or vice versa. Then the most important factor is expected return of income from different investment opportunities. Higher or less in expected return investing money in education and training or investment somewhere else. But later on, this manpower of approach of human capital model was criticized because in the market and real life situation, the research has shown that the wealth distribution and household earnings do not go with the distribution of education and training in the country. Sources of income and returns from schooling do not match with the level of education and training. There are other factors and forces in the society which also matters in the distribution of wealth. Otherwise, the economic status of a household would have been more or less equal to the other household whose educational status is more or less equal to other household with the same level of or type of education and training. So there exist in the system that other forces are also working to create disparities in the distribution of wealth in the country. These forces may be of social nature or due to political pulls. These forces of social nature or political pulls are seen by some economists as economic structure of a country. According to Lester Thurow, 1972, the distribution of income is determined by the distribution of job opportunities and not by the distribution of labor. Q. With a given education training, job opportunities indicate that the demand of jobs in the country and the labor. Job distribution, according to Thurow, is governed by three factors. The first factor is characteristic of a technical progress, wage determination, which is governed by the bargaining power of the trade unions or the wage differentials in the country extra. The third factor given by Thurow is the distribution of training cost between employees and the employers. So the management approach of manpower in the country is very crucial. Crucial issues like economic structure of the economy, job specifications, technical progress, role of trade unions, provision of education and training of the suitable time in the line with the job satisfaction and required skills. Labor laws and wages, investment in public health care and education and regulation of oversupply of labor should be monitored regularly. This would help in the management of manpower and regulating the demand and supply of manpower for given job opportunities in increasing range of professional and technical occupations. Oversupply of labors may lead to upgrade the qualifications required for entry into an occupation, resulting in the mismatch between demand and supply of the labor. It is quite possible that for the lower job, persons with high-grade educational qualifications and training may compete. This type of situation in the market would give signals of misplaced investment in education and professional training. This should not happen. In conclusion, it can be stated that education and training, schooling, may not bring the expected earning to an individual, but it could not be a wasteful expenditure, since the educated person is an asset to his or her family, to himself or herself, and society at large. Thank you.